safe space. Everybody needs to be put outside the safe space, and reality must not intrude. The South Park song about safe spaces is exactly what these people think. And let me tell you something about safe spaces. There's only one group of people who want safe spaces that are race specific. There are only one group of people that want safe spaces so that they never have to hear from anybody of a different ideology or political persuasion. Those people are called fascists. Okay, and you've got a bunch of fascists, damn fascists on this campus, who are trying to shut down political debate and trying to cloister themselves in this little cocoon of stupidity so they don't have to debate anyone or think about issues outside their kin so that they can feel comfortable. Guess what? Life isn't about feeling comfortable. Life is about bettering yourself. Get off your ass, you stupid pansies. Every fascist in the history of the world has his safe space. Every fascist has his safe space. It's terrible for you. It's terrible for this university. It's terrible for the country. Grow the hell up. You're in a safe space, thank God. It's called America. Learn to appreciate it or get out. I'm happy to take questions. Thanks so much. Don't all rush forward at once. It can be about anything. It doesn't have to be about me ranting at people. If by open forum it means you get to make a speech, the answer is no. There has to be a question mark at the end.
Yes.
I read you, yeah. Okay.
And this kind of goes back to the video you made about a year ago about the myth of the tiny radical
Muslim, yeah, the tiny radical Muslim minority, yeah.
So why do you think that liberals are so quick to sort of judge imagined racism in white people and white Americans, yet they seem to cover for it in Islam?
Yes, this is a good question. So the question is for people who, I mean, we have a mic, so I assume everybody heard it, but the basic question was, why is it that the left seems so comfortable siding with radical Islam in so many situations around the world? And the answer is because leftist philosophy is based on the philosophy of the oppressed versus the oppressor. Right? The way that the left judges the world is based on equality of outcome. All that matters is that everybody ends up equal. It doesn't matter equal opportunity. Leftism is based on the fundamental premise that everybody should end up the same. So if there are two guys in a room, one guy has $4 and one guy has $1, the guy with four must have exploited the guy with one. Or if there's a homeless guy and Bill Gates must have exploited the homeless guy somehow, even if the homeless guy can't afford a crappy version of Windows, right? He must have exploited him. Well, the same holds true internationally. So if you look internationally, Islamic countries tend to be incredibly poor because they're badly run and because they're oppressive and because they're tyrannical. And because all of that is true, these countries do not do well on the international stage. The left, however, just sees impoverished country, super wealthy America, super wealthy West. Western civilization must have made them poor through colonialism and imperialism. Therefore, we owe some sort of blood guilt on this, and so we have to be warm toward what are essentially philosophies of people who are impoverished. So the left believes that religious ideology is basically just a sheer cover on poverty. Right? The only reason that radical Muslims are radical is not because of radical Islam. They're radical Muslims because they are poor. And so if we could just rectify that situation, everything would be hunky dory. That's why they're so warm. They side with the oppressed versus the oppressor, and the oppressed are always the people who are poor, even if the oppressed are actually the oppressors and killing people. I think that the most potent thing that concerned students have done is they pushed a language that we have refused to fight. So that they say things, that they spout tautologies like racism exists. I agree. That was one of my fundamental premises at the beginning, right? Racism on an individual level definitely exists, of course. You'd be a fool to deny it. And then they say, okay, well, because there are individuals who are racist, everything is racist. You have to reject the logic. You have to call on them to show evidence. And you need some people with backbone. I mean, really, this is a... We now live in a country where the ultimate, the basically how everybody is silenced. Tim Wolf is a racist. He's a racist. How do we know he's a racist? Because he's a white guy, which is racist. Right? By the way, it is totally incredible to me that Tim Wolf is supposed to be this great beneficiary of white privilege, but your football coach, who gets paid $3.1 million a year and is a white guy, right? He's not a beneficiary of white privilege because he sides with concerned student 1950. Right? He's a good guy, so he's not a white privilege guy, or at least he recognizes his white privilege. But Tim Wolf has to lose his job, right? So the answer is that the sophistry of the left has no impact unless you internalize it. If you just refuse to accept the narrative that they are pushing, there's nothing they can do to you. What would have happened at this university if Tim Wolf had looked at Jonathan Butler and said, "Okay, so what?" Right? Really, what would have happened? What would have happened if he had said to Jonathan Butler, "You stepped into my car," right? If he said to Jonathan Butler, "Every racist incident that was reported to the police was fully investigated as appropriate under local, state, and federal law," which is true. Okay, if he had said that, and Jonathan Butler had kept hunger striking, do I think Jonathan Butler was going to die for his beliefs? I think mommy and daddy, who are worth $20 million, would probably have bought him a popsicle.
Hi, I'm Olivia. I'm with the Mizzou PR. I'm doing questions online, so these are going to be from Twitter. So David R. Shorten at D. Shorten Music wants to know, in the ideological war between left and right, what are the strongest weapons on both sides?
Well, the strongest weapon for the left is always character attacks, right? You're a racist, sexist, bigot, homophobe. It's actually the only argument that they have, generally speaking. They disagree with you, therefore you're a bad person. Right? This is what basically Barack Obama said this with regard to anybody who objects to his Syrian refugee idea, right? You're a bad person, you hate children, you hate women, you fear widows, right? You're a bad person. We can't actually have a logical discussion about the issue. You're just a bad person. That's the strongest argument on the left side. The strongest argument on the right side, presumably, which is why I'm on the right, is evidence and logic. The problem is that in an argument, evidence and logic actually tend to lose to character assault. Character assault tends to win. Because once you've been labeled a racist, no one wants to hear your evidence and your argument. And so, as I have frequently said, the biggest mistake that people on the right make is that when they are called a racist, sexist, bigot, homophobe, they then proceed to try and have a normal conversation with the person who labeled them this. Right? The proper answer to "you're a racist" is not, "You know what, let's have a discussion about race in America." The proper answer to "you're a racist" is, "No, you're an a-hole." Because for somebody to call you a racist without evidence is an a-hole thing to do. Right? You are not supposed to just drop character charges on people without any evidence of any sort. You're supposed to be able to back it up. So the right needs to start using that argument. It's effective, I know from personal experience, and it is a useful tool, because until we can get to the point where the left and the right actually have discussions about policy and not about character, nothing is going to happen that's good in American politics.
Of this university, I don't really have a question for you because I agree with most of what you say. I just wanted to say thank you for coming and helping us fight the fight here.
Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you, sir. Thank everybody for showing up, honestly, and being willing to stand up in the face of overwhelming media jackassery. Because I'm a frequent watcher of ESPN, which has now become basically MSNBC with footballs. And I was driving around campus today and not seeing bodies in the streets of poor black children, and not seeing the Ku Klux Klan on campus riding their white stallions, and not seeing Bull Connor anywhere with a hose, I was kind of surprised, because if you had watched the media coverage from outside this particular space, the impression that you got is that racism is endemic to the university, it is everywhere, and the cowardly administration that refuses to defend the university or itself backed into this by basically saying that, yes, we're racist, yes, mea culpa, maxima culpa, right? We must be racist, now please leave us alone, and then cowering in a corner like scared little girls. If that were the impression that you got from the university, that's because of the media. So thank you for coming out today, because I think this is the first time that the Mizzou community has shown that not everybody agrees with this nonsense, fascistic, tyrannical movement that's being pushed by the left. Give yourselves a hand, honestly.
Hi, I'm Josh Ferry. I have a lot of questions for you, so if you want to come over for Shabbat dinner.
Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you.
So, as a Jew, I obviously experience
other's play in order to tear down the system. I mean, there's a reason. It's an alliance. They're using, I mean, this actually has deep roots in certain leftist philosophy. There's a school of thought called the Frankfurt School. It was a Marxist school of thought that came to the United States in the 1920s and 1930s. They were expatriates from Germany, and they had realized that the Marxist description of the world, that the oppressed classes, the poor of the world, the proletariat, were going to rise up and take over the universe, all this was not true in the aftermath of World War I. And so they had to come up with a different strategy for how to make this happen, and one of the things that they suggested was polarize people along tribal lines, along racial lines, and then have everybody sort of attack the capitalist system as the source of all racism. And so you're seeing that alliance in action right now. I mean, that's really what you're seeing, because for goodness sake, I mean, forget the Black Lives Matter movement for a second. Think about the bizarre juxtaposition between the boycott, divest, sanctions movement against Israel and the LGBT crowd. Right? I mean, talk about something that makes no sense whatsoever, right? I mean, they literally kill gay people in certain parts of the Middle East, and there's actual legal punishment for homosexuality under the Palestinian Authority. But yet, the LGBT crowd will side with the anti-Israel crowd. That's because there's a broader agenda, not because they agree on every particular. The only way to fight that is by calling it out when you see it, and not caving to this generalized idea that America is a terrible, oppressive, terrible place. Honestly, the people at this university and through, we are privileged to live at such a time in history. You know, for all the problems that I have with the current administration, and for all the problems I have with the American left and the international left, and for all the skepticism I have about the future, this is, if you could live in any time of history, it would be right now. I mean, living right now is a magnificent thing, and living in America right now is the best any group of human beings has ever had it in the history of the world. And so having people rip down the system that built all of that, saying, oh yeah, we'll make things better by taking away all of the fundamental notions of freedom and liberty that undergird that, that truly is an evil goal.
My name is Victoria. I'm a freshman journalism student here. I actually have two questions for you. I'm in a class right now where our entire grade is based off of papers we have to write, specifically dealing with issues like how white privilege has affected marginalized groups of people over, like, throughout history.
Uh-huh.
Yes, something specific like that. It's not the journalism class, but how would you suggest, like, somebody, like, for me, for example, who believes that, you know, it's kind of bullshit, is when in the face that my entire grade is based off of
right.
doing something like this, and also, I saw you on the Dr. Drew show a few months ago when Zoe Ter put their hand on the back of your neck, and
it
I
is,
wanted
yes.
to know what happened with that.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you don't have to get in trouble. I'll do it. So the first answer as to should you sacrifice your grades in order to write correct things on your test, the answer is no. Don't sacrifice your grades. If you were to dig up my blue books from UCLA 15 years ago, you would find that I wrote like Lenin. Because in class I would speak up, but then all of the tests were anonymous. I never suggest to any student that they sacrifice their grades and their academic future on the altar of doing the right thing, because you're not going to get any points for it. Nobody's going to know about it. And these teachers, the intolerant ones, do have your grades in their hands, and to a certain extent your future in their hands. As far as the Zoe Ter incident, for people who didn't see this and don't know what she's referring to, it's kind of a fun story, so I'll tell it. So story time with Ben Shapiro. So about 3 months ago, you can find this online, go to YouTube. It was a very big story at the time. It was like the number one trending topic on Facebook and Twitter. I was invited to go on CNN Headline News on the Dr. Drew show. And I was invited to talk about how Caitlyn Jenner a hero or not? This is when ESPN was giving Caitlyn Jenner the hero award. You know, rather than soldiers who had limbs blown off and continued their athletic careers, right? No, Caitlyn Jenner was a hero for being an extraordinarily wealthy white man with a mental disorder. And the so they knew my opinion on this, obviously. I'd written about it. I'd spoken about it. And my belief, I there's something I like, and it's called science. And science suggests that if you have not a single cell in your body without a Y chromosome, except for your sperm cells, and if you still have all your appendages, and if you still have your twig and berries and all the rest of it, but you call yourself a woman, no. No, and this goes back to my feeling that your subjective view of yourself is completely irrelevant to me. I don't care what you think you are, I just care what you are. And so, you know, they knew what I was going to say. I'd made this very clear. The producer of the Dr. Drew show, who happens to be a former producer, he told me, on Jerry Springer, decided that it would be a wise idea to have on, to debate me, a guy by the name of Zoe Ter, who is a transgender woman, is a post-op transgender woman, and is a he, because he is still a he. You can lose the parts, and you are still a man. Okay, so they decide to sit the two of us next to each other. And so we're seated next to each other, and this debate starts, and why we are engaging in mass delusion. Right? Well, why are we doing the Emperor's New Clothes bit? All right, we all know Caitlyn Jenner's a man, and we're sitting here pretending Caitlyn Jenner's a woman. And at one point I said to one of the guys on the panel, would you date Caitlyn Jenner? Are you a straight guy? Would you date Caitlyn Jenner? And the answer, of course, is no, because Caitlyn Jenner still has a penis. Okay? It's the most feminine penis you've ever seen. And it's... And so I say this, and microaggressions everywhere. And just as I say, microaggressions lead to actual aggression. So what happened is I said this, and this transgender guy sitting next to me, he grabs me by the back of the neck on national TV and says, if you don't cut that out, you'll go home in an ambulance. I'll send you home in an ambulance, which is weird because ambulances don't go home. And so I was taken aback slightly, to have this guy who was speaking. What precipitated it is there was a point where he had said, "You don't understand genetics," and I said, "What are your genetics, sir?" And it was the "sir" that got to him. And so, his voice at least two octaves lower than mine, he growled at me, "You know, I'll send you home in an ambulance." And what was amazing about the experience was that everybody turned on me after a threat of physical violence and an actual legal battery on national television. They turned on me. You knew that was going to be offensive, didn't you? You knew that was going to be offensive. To which I said, I don't care. Right? That's not, my job is not to be inoffensive. My job is to tell the truth. I mean, you had me on this program to say exactly this. The outcome of this is that I went and did what really mostly to make the point that you're not supposed to be able to get away with this stuff. I went and I filed a police report for battery. And I did so because during the break, Zoe turned to me and said, I'll see you in the parking lot. They'd send security out to the outdoors with me. They'd send him to my car. He was threatening me on Twitter, saying, well, he would curb stomp me, et cetera. Which I have to say is deeply unladylike behavior. So the end result was that it goes from the police to the DA. It finally gets to the DA, and the DA says that we can't, this fact pattern we can't do. It's on video, but this fact pattern we can't do anything because the person who assaulted you, essentially the person who committed battery upon you, is a member of a victimized minority. Essentially, there is no doubt, none, that if I had been the one who grabbed Zoe Tur by the back of the neck and threatened to send him home in an ambulance, that I certainly would have been given some sort of probation. There's no question about it. I've talked to multiple police officers in the LAPD, and they assure me this is the case.
My name is Jackson, and I followed you on Twitter after seeing that on ESPN, and one of the best decisions of my life. My question to you has...
You need more stuff in your life, dude.
My question to you is about the Syrian refugee immigration, and what your opinion on that is, even though we have roughly... 50,000 homeless vets?
Yeah, I mean, the fact is that for me it's not even a matter of the number of people coming in, because in a free market economy, you know, all that does is just lower the price of labor. So it's I don't think it's a matter of straining our, it, it,
I think that it's not stupid to say you ought to look at the values of the people that you're bringing in? I would say that about people of any religion. And the fact is that when you're talking about people who are coming from a place like Syria, which has no history of democracy, no history of human rights, no history of basic American rights like freedom of speech, no idea of what equality of sexes looks like, there's going to be a culture clash. Look at Europe. Europe is full of culture clash because of the vast wave of Muslim immigration. So on those two levels, I'm extremely worried about the Syrian refugee wave. And by the way, question for the Ummah, right, the Muslim nation that is supposed to take everybody in. There are 1 billion Muslims on planet Earth, and there are 52 Islamists.